are you all guys here? Sleepless night from last 2 days, 3 days? Planning for a party after this? Not yet planned? So first of all, I'm really happy to be here, and thanks Dr. Sir for bringing this topic of imaginations. Pablo Picasso once told that everything that you can imagine is real. So there is no imagination. We human beings have not created anything till now which is not real. So whatever you imagine is real, and that's what Sir is trying to bring us, that we have to bring our horizon to a bigger and bigger scope so that we can imagine more and more and discover and invent more and more. That's the whole idea of this TED talk also, that we broaden your horizon with different kind of talks so that you can think in a bigger picture and try to imagine more and more. By the way, when I was invited for this TED talk, I was told that the theme is Infinity War. And I thought that I will have some superheroes here, somebody from comics, yeah, Avengers or Iron Man. I grew up reading Superman Group. So if anybody of you have read Superman Group, he is more of like Captain America. But my all-time favorite was Chacha Chaudhary and Sabu. Sabu would be someone like Hulk, yeah. But the best part is all of these people were more human, yeah. I could not relate anybody to Chacha Chaudhary, yeah, he was super intelligent, and I don't find that in Avenger or, you know, Marvel comics. By the way, the next 10 to 12 minutes, what I would like to point out here is that how do you control these super machines, yeah? We are growing very fast, we are developing new technology, we are developing new science, but how do you make sure that these machines are working for humans rather than against humans? Before I start, I want to put a disclaimer. Whatever I will talk here, whatever philosophy or imagination I will give here is my personal. It has nothing to do with my company. Yeah? My company can't take responsibility of all my imagination and weird philosophy. So, whom do you believe? All those people who are saying that artificial intelligence is the next big thing and it is as important as fire? Or should you believe people who are saying that at the end of the day, artificial intelligence and machine learning will annihilate the human beings? We will be ruled by machines. And this question cannot be answered in abstract, yeah? We need to have evidence. The only problem with such kind of questions are that when you find data, you find anecdotes for both the sides. So when you Google, you will find thousands of statements in support of artificial intelligence. And at the same time, we'll find thousands of statements against artificial intelligence. Then what should we do? Should we give up? Whatever we decide to do, anyways, technology will progress. Yeah? We can't control the progress of technology and progress of human beings. But what we can control, for example, we learned how to use fire for the benefit of human beings. But at the same time, we also had to learn how do you control the downside of fire so that it doesn't make disturb the society. Similarly, from my perspective, artificial intelligence is really a good tool which will help and benefit human beings, but at the same time, we will have to learn how to control it. So, what I'd like to talk here about is how do you prepare yourself, your society, your environment, your surrounding, that we have a proper control on this artificial intelligence, so that we can infuse in this artificial intelligence the morale, the values that we human beings have. So as a data scientist, my first love is data. Of course, after my wife and my kids, for sure. But what I did was I went to look for some data. And the simple question what we put forward was, how do the progress of artificial intelligence make you feel? And we reached out to different types of audience. One audience who are more technical, and one audience who are common people. And if you see the survey here, the results are not surprising. But for me, what was interesting was this numbers, concern, apprehension, and unease. The people on the common side, they reacted with more, you know, concern. And when I tried to look into the details of data, why they are concerned, why they feel uneasy, I drill down to a point where it says that they are concerned because of the jobs. They fear that they will lose their jobs. They fear that the privacy would be gone. They fear that there is no transparency in artificial intelligence, which is very obvious. We all should be concerned of it. Next slide, please. So as a data scientist, I said, this is not more convincing. I need to find more. Then I looked for some data from World Economic Forum and tried to find out their prediction for the next 10 years in the percentage of how much effort human will put on the systems and how much effort would be by machines. And if you see the projection, by 2025, it is estimated that the machines would be spending more time on the work than the human being. And this raised an alarm in my mind. Yeah? Oh, if that's the possibility, then I myself also lose my job. Could be, yeah? So, but still I was not convinced because it doesn't talk about the job scenario. It doesn't say how many jobs would be lost and how many jobs would be created. So what I did was that I went for more survey and I found out this survey from McKinsey International, and it says that by 2030 there would be a job displacement in the volume of 400 to 500 million. 400 to 500 million jobs would be displaced. And that's a really worrying situation, yeah. But at the same time, we would be creating in excess of 555 to 800 million jobs. Now, I don't want to go into discussion of what kind of job it would be, because to be very honest, none of us know. We don't know what is the future. But honestly speaking, as sir was talking about the first industrial revolution, the job before first industrial revolution and the jobs after first industrial revolution, or the jobs that we are doing right now, they're all different. Nobody would have imagined 10 years ago that we will have billions of jobs called mobile app developer. Or we will never thought that we will have a job called chatbot developers. So rest assured, we will be doing some work. Now, what kind of work we would be doing, I don't know. Could happen that you will turn up to be a drone traffic controller and you would be replacing the traffic controller on the street. Now, how do you dodge them? That is your problem. I don't know how to solve that. But as of now, we should not be worried about the job situation. Now, what happens normally when we talk about artificial intelligence and human intelligence? We start fighting. We start saying that artificial intelligence is more smarter than human beings. I grew up in Dumka, which is like 90 kilometers from here. Yeah? And me and my friend Deepak, we were district police champion for a couple of years. And that made our neighborhood believe that we are very intelligent, yeah? Because we could remember the country, capital, currency, and acronyms. When I moved to Ranchi for my plus two exam, for my plus two in Gimi Shamli, all of a sudden my intelligence got drastically reduced. I was not the first one to answer the questions in my probability math class. Our intelligence has a wrong understanding of our own intelligence. We always think of intelligence as a single dimension. So when you talk to your neighborhood or among yourself, you feel that people is someone is intelligent because he can do calculation more fast or he could remember many things. But actually, human intelligence is more than that. When we talk of human intelligence, we talk of emotional intelligence. We talk of ethics. We talk of creativity. We talk of imagination. Actually, you can't define human intelligence. We have so much of variety and options that it is very difficult to define what human intelligence is. So what I feel that when people compare artificial intelligence and say that in some due course of time artificial intelligence will take over human intelligence, I feel we are doing a mistake. Because when, for example, there is a program called AlphaGo, and AlphaGo is a game like a Chinese checker and chess, it's a combination of that, a Chinese game. And when the AlphaGo program beat the world Go champion, everyone started celebrating. Oh, look, this is the program. Now they have the capability to beat the best human brain. But actually, it was not only AlphaGo as a program. It was a team of some developers who were working with AlphaGo to defeat this person. When we talk of robots in the factory doing some job, there is always a team who is controlling this robot. So I personally feel that in future, we all would be paid, our salary would be there, keeping in mind how well you work together with this machine. So do not look up to this machine as someone who is against you. We have to work together with them. Now there's an economist called Daniel Kahneman. I don't know if you've heard about him. He is a Nobel Prize winner. And he said that our thinking, human beings have two types of thinking. He called system one and system two. System one is more reflexive, it's unconscious. So something happens immediately and your system one comes into act and you start doing it. For example, if someone asks you the gap between these two, you can immediately tell, ah, this one is back, this one is front. And then we have system two, which is more like a sequential, it's orthodox, it takes time, it puts logic to understand. Exactly. So when the researchers, when they talk about artificial intelligence, they broadly categorize artificial intelligence into artificial narrow intelligence, which is all your smart speakers, autonomous driving cars. They can do some particular task. And then we have a artificial general intelligence. So it is still 10 to 15 years away, and this would be something like it can do everything that human can do. And then there will be a time when we will be building artificial super intelligence. That means that would be the last machine which we human will create, because after that machine can itself create more smarter machines. And different philosophies are there that it will take 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. I don't know about exact how much years it will take. But right now we are in the left side. Yeah? My problem is, next slide please. My problem is that all these machines that we are talking of, about your autonomous driving car, every day, every minute, every second, when you are driving this car, autonomous car on the street, they are making some moral decisions. So this is an example from MIT labs, and there are three different scenarios. In first scenario, there is an autonomous car, there is no passenger in that car, and that car sees a dog and a thief. Now, the accident cannot be avoided. It has to hit somebody. Whom should it hit? The second situation is that there are five people sitting in the car with a kid also, and there are five people on the road with a kid also, and there is a blocker here. Should the car hit them, or should it hit the blocker? And the third situation is that there is empty car, there is a dog, and this dog is evil dog, yeah? And then there is a thief. Whom should it hit? All I want to bring here is that, do artificial intelligence have ethics? Does it have moral value that human beings have? And this is what we have to solve. So what I propose, or my hope, is that we should create an artificial intelligence that uses its intelligence to learn what humans value. And it is the turning point, as our director sir was saying, that technology will keep and go, but what we have is a process, what we have is the humanity. And this is what I want to say. So I have some pointers here as a solution to this, and it's not an exhaustive list. But for example, we can start with that we have to explicitly define the ethical behavior. That means when such a situation happens, we as a human being have to already tell that to the system, that if this is a situation, this should be done. For example, in Germany, the committee for autonomous car, they already have explicitly given direction that whenever you see a human being on the street, the first priority would be that you have to save the human being. So you don't have to think about whether it's a dog or it's a rock, no. The first priority is the human being. They have also explicitly said that if there is a human being, you should not think about whether he is old or he has some problem, he's of a different race, he's different skin color. No, it's a human being, it's a human being. Second would be bringing transparency. So when we talk about artificial intelligence, half of the population says, ah, this is too complex, there is a neural network, there is this algorithm, I can't scrutinize it. For sure, that is true. But what we can do always is keep the log of the decision that it had made. So if I have the log why it did what it did, I can always come back and say, hey, this was the problem. I can always fix it. Third would be bridging the gap between system one and system two. Right now, all the artificial intelligence tools that we are talking of, they are getting created based on system one. It's reflexive, it immediately takes an action. If we can bring the ethics, morale, and all these values into the system one, we would be more secure society. And fourth one, bringing accountability. I can't say that, hey, that was autonomous car and it hit a pedestrian. We have to bring into accountability that car was owned by a company or a group of people and they are responsible for it. What all I want to bring here is that we have to construct an artificial intelligence system whose motivation is to protect human beings. Whose motivation is that it has the same moral, it has learned the same values what we would approve of. And for sure, we all should agree on this, and I also acknowledge that technology is always ahead of our time. Yeah? So we are always trying to catch up. Yeah? So something is discovered, and then we try to start putting rules and regulation on that. Correct? But in this game, somehow, we have to be ahead. Because the impact, right now, you would have heard Elon Musk and all those people saying artificial intelligence will annihilate human beings. Stephen Hawking said that it will kill the universe. We have to be ahead of this. So, humanity will change. Humanity will change more in the next 20 years than in the last 200 years. The artificial intelligence and machine learning that we build today will decide the future of artificial intelligence that has to come. And as somebody, I think, sir, you were saying that we still don't know what will be the job in the next 20 years. We have to make sure that we create artificial intelligence that values human values. And my fear is that artificial intelligence will also change the human value. Look at it around us. Our social IQ has changed completely. We have WhatsApp, we have Facebook, we hardly meet our friends. And this change happened unnoticed. Yeah? You never realize when it happened. Similarly, our human value will change unnoticed. And before it happens, we have to make sure that we are prepared. That's all.